Information and Media, Ms. Galia.
Your Excellency, the Honourable Speaker of the Fijian Parliament, as the head of the European Union Delegation for the Pacific, Your Excellency Sujiro Sim, members of the Diplomatic Corps, Your Excellencies, the Commissioner of Western Aid Team, Mr. Misaki Lendua, Permanent Secretary for Women, Children and Poverty Alleviation, Ms. Poole, government officials, distinguished guests, director and staff of Medical Services Pacific, congratulations. And members of the media that are here, and also acknowledge that we have other CSOs such as friends that are here today. This morning I woke up at 4 o'clock, at 5 o'clock I got picked up, and I've been on the road on the western side. Beginning at Rakiraki, I sat down at 8 o'clock and started talking to our teams, Rakiraki, Ba, and then Tawua. Tawua, and then Ba, and now I'm here, and I thank God I made it in time at 12 o'clock. One of the things that we were talking about is, first and foremost, I thank them for the work that we've been doing. And also, as you are aware, since Cyclone Winston, we've had quite an extensive damages to our facilities in the West. And as of the beginning of last year, we were able to complete all those important renovations that have to be done. Some of them, like Rakiraki and Tahoe, needed up to nearly $3 million to be able to keep them up to par. One of our health centers, Nassau, up in the hills, of Ra, we're hoping to reopen somewhere around the middle of next month. So I thank them. The second thing I said to them was in 2019, end of 2018, 2019 beginning, we had a massive public health campaign, which is Men C, and we had to vaccinate. So we vaccinated about 290,000 of our children. And over a period of 6 months, and unfortunately, we lost about 5 lives. At the end of 2019, we had measles, and we had a massive public health campaign. We became granted vaccinations. We were able to vaccinate about nearly 500,000 of our people within 6 weeks. We ended on Christmas Eve in 6 weeks. And as you all know, we had 33 children that had measles, and none of them died. And some of them were admitted into the intensive care units, but none passed on. Last year was another big public health campaign, which was COVID-19. And the work around COVID-19. And working together with government, led by the Honourable Prime Minister and everyone, including CSOs, we've been able to keep this country COVID-19 contained. But this year, there's another massive public health campaign. As you are aware, this is the year of vaccination. So one of the things that I was talking to our staff was that we must not drop this ball. We must not drop this ball. It's been tiring, exhausting, but the purpose and the focus must be very clear. Our role is to protect lives. And we must work hand in hand. They must do their groundwork. They must go out into the community. They must reprofile their communities. They must understand who is vulnerable. They must note them down. We must register everyone that we need to vaccinate. And also just encouraging them that the fight is not yet completed. As you look at what's happening with COVID-19 right around the world, you can see that the strength of health system is not dependent on the number of ventilators or intensive care units. It is dependent on the ability of the health system to be resilient in the midst of a crisis. And that is called what is called resilience dividend. In the midst of a crisis, being able to make gains. And that's one thing that we as a government and as a Minister of Health and Medical Services, we aspire to, that in the midst of this crisis, we continue to make gains. And in the midst of this crisis, I congratulate Medical Services Pacific that though there is a crisis, that they continue to make gains. And the gains is what we're witnessing today, the opening of this magnificent center here in Lautoka. Reproductive healthcare is enshrined in the Fiji's constitution, and we, the Minister of Health and Medical Services, reproductive health policy for Fiji. Policy supports the rights of all women, men and children to have access to curative, preventive, reproductive health services. We have embarked as an organization in universal health coverage. And universal health coverage is a principle of leaving no one behind and reaching the unreached. It's based on population health rather than what your insurance brings. The Because at the end of the day, we want to make sure that everyone has access. That the person in Onilau and the person on Vetaro Street, right across the street here, both have equal access to healthcare. It is not a difficult ask. It is about making sure that we be innovative in the way that we do things. It also takes notes of the rights of young people to have access to friendly services, access to sexual reproductive health information that will help them to make responsible choices, and in particular prevent unplanned early pregnancies, STIs, HIV, and sexual abuse. I find this very interesting because His Excellency and I were at an opening or inauguration of Sexual Reproductive HIV AIDS Week. And at the end of it, in the following news media and also on social media, there were a lot of discussions about some of the words that were uttered around why should we be telling our children to be practicing safe sex. I think all of us in this room and the whole nation understands that this subject cannot be a taboo subject. This subject cannot be a subject that we just miss-pass, a common rugby term, miss-pass. You throw the ball from the first 5-8 to the wing, and you miss out the second 5-8 at the center. We must bear the brunt. We must be there. We must discuss it. And there's no one better who's done it and been in the forefront than His Excellency, the former President, and the current Speaker of the House. Our 20-year National Development Plan aims to provide better quality family planning services, better maternal child health services, efficient sexual reproductive health information, services and resources, and improved adolescent health services. Furthermore, the government looks to implement policies encouraging shared decision-making in relationships, family planning, child care, economic independence, and choices of paid work in line with SDG 5. In 2015, the WHO reported that reproductive health issues are responsible for one-third of health issues for women between the reproductive years of 15 and 44. The maternal health complications still remain a challenge. Furthermore, the prevalence of sexually transmitted infections and sexual violence against women also remains at the very top of the global health agenda for women. Our strategic plan 20 to 2025 states that the civil society organizations provide additionally complementary service in hard-to-reach areas and specialized services. They include psychosocial and mental health support, wash in water sanitation hygiene, and sexual and reproductive health and rights services in outreaches conducted in communities and schools. Cross-government partnerships have been a critical part of our ministry's work. I've been very pleased with the work that was done with TCRs. Was actually part of the team stationed in Likutu for about nearly 2 weeks. I was very pleased to see so many CSOs working in that space, helping us reach the unreached. And MSP was actually one of them. And I saw a few of them as I came in this morning. So thank you once again. From what I read about Medical Services Pacific, I know this is an organization that supports the work of the Minister of Health and Medical Services. In fact, some of their staff have been embedded into our female. Fiji Emergency Medical Assistance Team in some of the deployments that have been done in the past. We provide services through post-rape care clinic and mobile outreach clinic, working in coordination with teams in our divisions to provide sexual reproductive health clinical services and raise awareness on sexual reproductive health and rights, gender equality, child protection, social inclusion, and sexual gender-based violence. We know that when people suffer from sexual gender-based violence, there is a range of support that they need. And that support needs to be holistic. It is not entirely all within the Minister of Health facilities. And this is where CSOs such as MSP is very helpful to us. They provide healthcare, they provide counseling, and at times legal advice and ongoing counseling and support. So I commend MSP. Congratulate you for stepping and taking up this challenge to provide this range of support and assistance, including your one-stop-shop initiative, providing integrated post-rape care services, rights-based holistic model for survivors of sexual gender-based violence. I encourage you to continue the good work you are doing, and I wish you the very best of luck. Also like to thank the European Union. Thank you, sir, for the support that you're giving. Not only MSP, but also the many CSOs that provide work in helping us with social protection. With those words, I have much pleasure in being here and also being able to, later on this morning, unveil the plaque that officially opens his MSP Lautoka clinic. Thank you very much.